first reading and the second reading. It's going to be the Passion of Sins at year end. This is it, one of the 12. That's the one. Okay, so start from there. I'll try and find you the stand.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll stand nearby. If you have any problems, just call on me, but I don't think you will. And you read everything with Emma, yeah?
Yeah. Please stand. A reminder, anyone wishing to go to confessions, Father Michael is currently in the confessional box. Almighty ever-living God, who as an example of humility for the human race to follow, caused our Saviour to take flesh and submit to the cross, graciously grant that we may heed his lesson of patient suffering and so merit a share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated.
Reading from the prophet Isaiah. The Lord has given me a disciple's tongue, so that I may know how to reply to the wearied. He provides me with speech. Each morning he wakes me to hear, to listen like a disciple. The Lord has opened my ear. For my part, I made no resistance, neither did I turn away. I offered my back to those who struck me, my cheeks to those who tore up my beard. I did not cover my face against insult and spittle. The Lord comes to my help so that I am untouched by the insults. So too, I set my face like flint. I know I shall not be shamed. The word of the Lord.
They
Second reading, a reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. His state was divine, yet Christ Jesus did not cling to his equality with God, but emptied himself to assume the condition of a slave, and became as men are, and being as all men are, he was humbler yet, even to accepting death, death on a cross. But God raised him high and gave him the name which is above all other names, so that all beings in the heavens, on earth, and in the underworld should bend the knee at the name of Jesus, and that every tongue should acclaim Jesus Christ as Lord, to the glory of God the Father. The word of the Lord.
It was 2 days before the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and the chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to arrest Jesus by some trick and have him put to death. For they said,
"It must not be during the festivities, or there will be a disturbance among the people."
Jesus was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper. He was at dinner when a woman came in with an alabaster jar of very costly ointment, pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the ointment on his head. Some who were there said to one another indignantly,
"Why this waste of ointment? Ointment like this could have been sold for over 300 denarii and the money given to the poor."
And they were angry with her. But Jesus said,
"Leave her alone. Why are you upsetting her? What has she done for me is of good works. You have the poor with you always, and you can be kind to them whenever you wish. But you will not always have me. She has done what was in her power to do. She has anointed my body beforehand for its burial. I tell you solemnly, wherever throughout the world the good news is proclaimed, what she has done will be told also in remembrance of her."
Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, approached the chief priests with an offer to hand Jesus over to them. They were delighted to hear it and promised to give him money. And he looked for a way of betraying him when the opportunity should occur. On the first day of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb was sacrificed, his disciples said to him,
"Where do you want us to go and make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?"
So he sent two of his disciples, saying to them,
"My disciples, he will show you a large upper room furnished with couches all prepared.
The disciples set out and went to the city and found everything as he had told them and prepared the Passover. When evening came, he arrived with the 12, and while they were eating at table, Jesus said,
"I tell you solemnly, one of you is about to betray me, one of you eating with me."
They were distressed and asked him one after another,
"Not I, surely."
He said to them, and as they were eating, he took some bread, and when he had said the blessing, broke it to them and gave it to them, saying,
"Take it, this is my body."
Then he took a cup, and when he had returned thanks, he gave it to them, and all drank from it. And he said to them,
"This is my blood, the blood of the covenant, which is to be poured out for many. I tell you solemnly, I shall not drink any more wine until the day I drink the new wine in the kingdom of God."
After psalms had been sung, they left for the Mount of Olives, and Jesus said to them,
"You will all lose faith, for the scripture says, I shall strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. However, after my resurrection, I shall go before you to Galilee."
Peter said,
"Even if all lose faith, I will not."
And Jesus said to him,
"I tell you solemnly, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times."
But he repeated, still more earnestly,
"If I have to die with you, I will never disown you."
And they all said the same. They came to a small estate called Gethsemane, and Jesus said to his disciples,
"Stay here while I pray."
Then he took Peter and James and John with him. And a sudden fear came over him and great distress. And he said to them,
"My soul is sorrowful to the point of death. Wait here and keep awake."
And going on a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, this hour might pass him by. He said, he came back and found them sleeping, and he said to Peter,
"Simon, are you asleep? Have you not the strength to keep awake 1 hour? You should be awake and pray not to be put to the test. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak."
Again, he went away and prayed, saying the same words. And once more, he came back and found them sleeping. Their eyes were so heavy, and they could find no answer for him. He came back a third time and said to them,
"You can sleep on now and take your rest. It is all over. The hour has come. Now the Son of Man is to be betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up, let us go. My betrayer is close at hand already."
Even while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, came up with a number of men armed with swords and clubs sent by the chief priests and the scribes and the elders. Now, the traitor had arranged a signal with them. He had said,
"The one I kiss, he is the man. Take him in charge and see he is well guarded when you lead him away."
So when the traitor came, he went straight up to Jesus and said,
"Rabbi,"
and kissed him. The others seized him and took him in charge. Then one of the bystanders drew his sword and struck out at the high priest's servant and cut off his ear. Then Jesus spoke,
"Am I agreeing that you had to set out to capture me with swords and clubs? I was among you teaching in the temple day after day, and you never laid hands on me. But this is to fulfill the scripture."
And they all deserted him and ran away. A young man who had followed him had nothing on but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the cloth in their hands and ran away naked. They led Jesus off to the high priest, and all the chief priests and the elders and the scribes assembled there. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the high priest's palace, and was sitting with the attendants, warming himself at the fire. The chief priests and the whole Sanhedrin were looking for evidence against Jesus on which they might pass the death sentence. But they could not find any. Several, indeed, brought false evidence against him, but their evidence was conflicting. Some stood up and submitted this false evidence against him.
"We heard him say, 'I'm going to destroy this temple made by human hands, and in 3 days build another, not made by human hands.'"
But even on this point, their evidence was conflicting. The high priest then stood up before the whole assembly and put this question to Jesus.
"Have you no answer to that? What is this evidence these men are bringing against you?"
But he was silent and made no answer at all. The high priest put a second question to him.
"Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed One?"
Jesus said,
"I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power and coming."
The high priest tore his robes and said,
"What lead of witnesses have we now? You heard the blasphemy. What is your finding?"
And they all gave their verdict. He deserved to die. Some of them started spitting at him and blindfolding him, began hitting him with their fists and shouting,
"Pay the prophet."
And the attendants rained blows on him. While Peter was down below in the courtyard, one of the high priest's servant girls came up. She saw Peter warming himself there and stared at him and said,
"You too were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth."
But he denied it, saying,
"I do not know. I do not understand what you are talking about."
And he went into the forecourt. The servant ghost saw him and again started telling the bystanders,
"This fellow is one of them."
But again he denied it. A little later, the bystanders themselves said to Peter,
"You are one of them for sure. Why, you are a Galilean?"
But he started calling curses on himself and swearing,
"I do not know the man you speak of."
At that moment, the cock crew for the second time, and Peter recalled how Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will have disowned me three times." And he burst into tears. First thing in the morning, the chief priests, together with the elders and the scribes, in short, the whole Sanhedrin, had their plan ready. They had Jesus bound and took him away and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate questioned him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
He answered, and the chief priests brought many accusations against him. Pilate questioned him again.
"Have you no reply at all? See how many accusations there are being against you."
But to Pilate's amazement, Jesus made no further reply. At the festival time, Pilate used to release a prisoner for them, anyone they asked for. Now, a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rioters who had committed murder during the uprising. When the crowd went up and began to ask Pilate for the customary favor, Pilate then answered them,
"Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?"
For he realized it was out of jealousy that the chief priest had handed Jesus over. The chief priest, however, had incited the crowd to demand that he should release Barabbas for them instead. Then Pilate spoke again.
"But in that case, what am I to do with the man you call king of the Jews?"
They shouted back,
"Crucify him."
Pilate then asked them,
"Why? What harm has he done?"
But they shouted all the louder,
"Crucify him."
So Pilate, anxious to placate the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and having ordered Jesus to be scourged, handed him over to be crucified. The soldiers led him away to the inner parts of the palace, that is, the praetorium, and called the whole cohort together. They dressed him up in purple, twisted some thorns into a crown, and put it on him. And they began saluting him.
"Hail, King of the Jews!"
They struck his head with a reed and spat on him, and they went down on their knees to do him homage. And when they had finished making fun of him, they took off the purple and dressed him in his own clothes. They led him out to crucify him. They enlisted a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, father of Alexander and Rufus, who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. They brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. They offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he refused it. Then they crucified him and shared out his clothing, casting lots to decide what each should get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The inscription giving the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." And they crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. The passers-by jeered at him. They shook their heads and said,
"Aha, so you would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, then save yourself, come down from the cross."
The chief priests and the scribes mocked him among themselves in the same way. They said,
"He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now for us to see it and believe."
Even those who were crucified with him taunted him. When the sixth hour came, there was a darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "This means,
my God, why have you deserted me?"
When some of those who stood by heard this, they said,
"Listen, he's calling on Elijah."
Someone ran and soaked a sponge in vinegar and, putting it on a reed, gave it to him to drink, saying,
"Wait and see if Elijah will come to take him down."
But Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last. And the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The centurion who was standing in front of him had seen how he had died and said,
"In truth, this man was a son of God."
There was some woman watching from a distance. Among them were Mary of Magdala, Mary who was the mother of James the younger, and Joseph and Salome. These used to follow him and look after him when he was in Galilee. And there were many other women there who had come up to Jerusalem with him. It was now evening, and since it was the preparation day, that is, the vigil of the Sabbath, there came Joseph of Arimathea, a prominent member of the council, who himself lived in hope of seeing the kingdom of God. And he boldly went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Pilate, astonished that he should have died so soon, summoned the centurion and inquired if he was already dead. Having been assured of this by the centurion, he granted the corpse to Joseph, who brought a shroud and took Jesus down from the cross, wrapped him in the shroud, and laid him in a tomb which had been hewn out from the rock. He then rolled a stone against the entrance to the tomb. Mary of Magdala and Mary, the mother of Joseph, were watching and took note of where he was laid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Holy Week is one of the most significant and sacred weeks in our faith, in which we pray and reflect on the profound journey of Jesus' suffering, sacrifice, and victory over death. Palm Sunday commemorates Jesus' entry into Jerusalem. Holy Thursday celebrates the Last Supper and the institution of the Eucharist, while Good Friday reflects on Jesus' death by crucifixion. Throughout this week, we should reflect on the emotional intensity of Jesus' passion, contemplate his boundless love and mercy, and anticipate the joyous hope of his resurrection. Our first gospel outside commemorated Jesus' triumphal entry into Jerusalem. The crowd cried, "Hosanna." Hosanna is often thought of as a declaration of praise, but it is actually a plea for salvation. Literally, Hosanna means, "I beg you to save," or "Please deliver us." The crowd acknowledged Jesus as the Messiah, yet by the end of the week, they had crucified him. The question today for us is, will we witness to our faith regardless of the cost? In tomorrow's gospel, we hear of Mary anointing Jesus' feet and people complaining about the extravagance of that. And we might ask ourselves, would we give everything who we are to the Lord if asked? On Tuesday, we join with Jesus at the Last Supper. Jesus was troubled in spirit because he knew that Judas was about to betray him. The question we might ask ourselves is, are we committed to carrying out the Father's will in our lives, even when those closest to us might betray us? Wednesday offers us one of the most poignant days of Holy Week. Jesus and Judas are playing out their representative choices. Jesus is greatly distressed, not just for himself, but also because of Judas's betrayal. He says, "Alas for that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. Better for that man if he had never been born." This might sound like a threat, but it is genuine grief. Jesus became man so that everyone would be saved. And now one of his dearest friends, one of his apostles, is about to betray him. A question for us is, do we show similar concern for those who hurt us? Are we worried about what action is going to be done? The action to them rather than to me. On Holy Thursday, we commemorate the institution of the Eucharist and the institution of the priesthood. When Jesus was conceived, the angel said he would be called Emmanuel, God with us. The real presence of Jesus is present in the Eucharist, his body, blood, soul, and divinity. John's Gospel mentions the Last Supper, but doesn't give us the words of institution. Instead, it gives us the last testimony of Jesus. We are told Jesus knew that the Father had put everything into his hands and that he had come from God and was returning to God. During the Eucharist on Holy Thursday, we have the washing of the feet. And we could ask ourselves, are we willing to wash the feet of our brothers and sisters? I.e., do I have the eye to see the needs of those around me? And do I have the generosity of heart to humbly serve everyone who has a need? The Passion of Jesus begins in earnest in the Garden of Gethsemane on Thursday night. And Jesus begs his Father, if it be possible, to take this cup from him. How often have I asked the same question? Have I begged God to deliver me from some particular moment or event in my life? Am I able to pray with Jesus? Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. Am I able to hand over my fear and my worries and suffering to a Father in whom I should place all my trust? Good Friday is when everything comes to a head. We've been reading over the last number of weeks how the Jewish authorities were trying to find ways to kill Jesus. And the perfect situation presents itself when Judas offers of his own free will to betray Jesus into their hands. On Good Friday, we have the celebration of the Lord's Passion. That might seem an oxymoron, two things that should not go together, celebration and passion. But we don't celebrate the death of Jesus. We celebrate his faithfulness to God the Father's will. We celebrate his humility, his obedience, which brings about our salvation. Am I willing to be obedient to God's will in my life? Am I willing to die to myself and my own will in order to obey God? Let us live this Holy Week intentionally. Let us walk with Jesus through his betrayal and pain and suffering, so that we might enter into the Easter Vigil with true joy, hope, and love. Let us read the Gospel of each day, even if you cannot attend the church. Go and meet Jesus, the Divine Mercy, or in the Sacrament of Reconciliation. Live this week intentionally. Even if you have fallen off the wagon or lost your fervor or not carried out your Lenten promises, but engage in acts of mercy so that people may see Christ in you. Let each of us be Christians and bring Christ to others. We stand to profess our faith, and we pray the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us turn in prayer to the Father through the Son, who journeyed into Jerusalem and embrace the cross for our salvation.
For the Church, that Christ's passion may awaken in us a desire to serve the Church with generosity of spirit. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the King, his government, and for the well-being and health of the royal family, may all in public office govern with wisdom and compassion, mindful of the least of the many and not the few. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For peace, that a spirit of self-sacrifice might conquer the divisions that exist throughout our world. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Let us pray for all those to be baptized, received, and confirmed this Easter. Together may we may grow in our love for the Eucharist and witness to Christ's self-giving love. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For all those who suffer in mind or body, that they may unite their sufferings to the sufferings of Christ. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the faithful departed, for all who have died recently, including Helen Akua Adia, Ellen Bothwick, Teresa Griffin, Caris Luton, Lavinia Staines, and Anna Chiguro, and for all those whose anniversaries occur about this time, including Mary Baxter, Forrest Chan Fett, Mary Curran, Pat Walsh, Edward Sumler, Elizabeth Farrankin, and Anna Whittle. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Let us pray with Mary, Mother of Sorrows, as we say,
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and in the hour of our death. Amen.
God our Father, grant us a share of the courage, serenity, and strength that enable Christ to enter into Jerusalem and endure the cross. We ask this and all our prayers through Christ our Lord.
We sing number 237. Number 237.
Pray, brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Through the passion of your only begotten Son, O Lord, may our reconciliation with you be near at hand, so that though we do not merit it by our own deeds, yet by this sacrifice made once for all, we may feel already the effects of your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We give you the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For though innocent, he suffered willingly for sinners, and accepted unjust condemnation to save the guilty. His death has washed away our sins, and his resurrection has purchased our justification. And so with all the angels we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim.
Sanctus, Sanctus, Sanctus.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and, giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, with St. Alban and St. Stephen, and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Vincent, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom, there we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Saviour's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your Church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
On your day, quito.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
Deus, Deus meus, respice in me, quare me derelinquisti. Longeo salute mea verba delictorum meorum. Deus meus, diem et non exaudies, et nocte et non ad incipientiam mihi.
Padre, si non potest hic calix transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
In te speraverunt patres nostri, speraverunt et liberas dies. Ego autem sunt vermis et non homo, opprobrium hominum et abiectio plebis.
Pater, si non potest hic calix transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
Patum est cor meum tamquam cera liquescens, in medio ventris mei. Quoniam circumdederunt me canes multi, concilium malignantitium omnes.
majestic calis transire. Nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
Quoniam circumdederant mecanes multis, foderunt manus meas et pedes meos, dinum meraverunt omnia ossa mea. Ipsi vero consideravunt et inspexerunt me, diviserunt sibi vestimenta tua, et super vestem meam miserunt sorte.
Pate, si non potest hic calis transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
Salva me ex ore leonis, et a cornibus unicornium humilitate mea. Narobum nomen tuum fratribus meis, in medio ecclesiae laudamus.
Pater, si non potest hic calis transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
Qui dimittis Dominum laudate eum, universum semen Iacob glorificate. Reminiscentur et converpentur ad Dominum, universi fines tere.
Pater, si non potest hic calix transire, nisi bibam illum, fiat voluntas tua.
We sing number 752. Number 752.
Love to the love and show me.
Let us pray. Nourished with these sacred gifts, we humbly beseech you, O Lord, that just as through the death of your Son, you have brought us to hope for what we believe, so by his resurrection you may lead us to where you call, through Christ our Lord. Please take a copy of the Holy Week card, which has details of our Holy Week services and additional confession times. Good Friday is a day of fasting when we have one main meal and two light snacks. It is also a day of abstinence when we are asked not to eat meat. Following the liturgy on Good Friday afternoon, there will be the customary retiring collection for the holy places. The needs of the Christian community living in the Holy Land are greater today than at any time in our lives. Please be generous. On Tuesday of this week, Father Michael and myself will be joining the Cardinal, Bishops and Clergy of the Diocese for the Chrism Mass in Westminster Cathedral. During this Mass, the Cardinal will bless the holy oils to be used during the year, and the priests of the diocese will renew their priestly promises. There will be no morning Mass on Tuesday, but there will be an evening Mass at 7 p.m. on Tuesday evening. Please take a copy of one, other, or both of the Holy Week Easter posters that are available in the porch and display them prominently in a front room window. If you are away over Easter and wish to contribute to the Easter offering, Easter offering envelopes are available in the porch. The Easter offering helps fund the monthly allowance received by the priests of the parish. Thank you for your patience during this Mass today. Please bow your heads for the blessing. Look, we pray, O Lord, on this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ did not hesitate to be delivered into the hands of the wicked and submit to the agony of the cross, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you. And with your spirit. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
the championship.